Of the night under a rain-pelted roof, Thank you so much for coming. Thanks to the people in the room and everybody who's watching on YouTube. And I want to thank Google, of course, for all their work in putting this together, MIT Tech Review for their great work in putting this together, and our wonderful panelists, Nicco, who is the director of the Shorenstein Center at Harvard, and Deb Roy, who is a professor at MIT and also the chief media scientist at Twitter, which is an interesting thing to be in this year. You know, I had a conversation a couple months ago with Neil Gabler, who some of you may know. He's written a lot of books about Hollywood. And like I said, this is a few months back, and while they were waiting to set up the microphones to do the radio interview, we got talking, and he said, you know, the reason that people got things wrong with Donald Trump, where they didn't see Donald Trump, you know, sort of rising up and potentially getting the Republican nomination, was because people were asking the wrong people. They were asking political scientists, and they were asking people who've been in politics. But really, Donald Trump is a media story. And they should be asking the people. Neil Gabler's written big books about Walt Disney and Walter Winchell, and I was interviewing him about Barbara Streisand. And he said they should have been asking the media people. So I will start there and ask you, Nicco, is what we are seeing this year in the political domain, a media story in a different way, or more of a media story than anything we've ever seen before?
Boy, I think that
one way of understanding what's happening in this election is multiple trends kind of culminating at the same time. One trend is a political process and system that is in desperate need of reform and overhaul. The last time we looked at the presidential nomination process in any real depth was 1968. You know, it's 2 years long. I'm not sure it makes any sense in the modern era. Another trend we're seeing is this is the most diffuse media landscape that we've ever had in a presidential election. You know, the 2012 election was only 4 years ago, but in fact, a lot has changed in 4 years in terms of media consumption habits and technology and devices that have been that people are using. Just even smartphone penetration has significantly grown in that time, and over-the-top television, right, exists. And then I think another trend is, some of the economic trends of underemployment and unemployment. Chronic unemployment and the way those have fueled a kind of rage and frustration. And so across the board, we kind of see all these things coming together at once. And there's no doubt that part of what's going on here is a big media story with Donald Trump. You know, Matt Bai wrote a book that came out before Donald Trump declared, right before he declared his running, almost 2 years ago, called All the Truth Is Out. And the book is about the 1988 presidential campaign, where the leading Democrat was Gary Hart. That in '84, Gary Hart had come out of nowhere to almost beat Walter Mondale for the nomination. And in '88, here's Gary Hart running, and he is one of the great, you know, thinkers and politicians, a rising star. And what Matt Bai argues in that book is that there was this moment when the press, the news, decided to cover Gary Hart really as entertainment, looking at his adultery and his cheating on his wife, instead of as a presidential candidate. And that kind of put the ball in motion. That was an adjustment. If you think about the values of journalism and news as a dial, that was an adjustment that tilted us significantly towards entertainment, and that in it's a prescient book in the sense it in many ways anticipates Donald Trump's candidacy.
Deb, tell me a little bit about, I mean, here you are, you know, part of Twitter in a year when who could have imagined how important Twitter would become? And yes, right, in good ways and bad ways, the whole thing. And you know, I mean, sort of back to this, the issue of like the importance of the media. Donald Trump, who I think has used the media in incredible ways this year, isn't just a politician who knows how to use the media. He's a media star. I mean, that's really what he is. He wasn't like a governor or senator. He's a star. What have you thought as you've sort of watched this unfold? And, you know, obviously Twitter is something that matters to you.
Yeah, I think the idea of election being a media story is, maybe to echo what you're saying, is not entirely new. We've had actors become president. We've had professional wrestlers become governors. So there's a, you know, there's past precedent. But I do believe that something significant has changed, and we already saw it in earlier form in 2012. I think we're seeing it in spades now, and Twitter has played clearly a kind of central role, as has several of the major social media platforms, and more generally, all of these are just different facets of the internet, which is, you know, when you say media story, there is the mainstream media, there is, for Donald Trump, what The Apprentice, Celebrity Apprentice, did to establish a brand larger than life. And then there is, you know, before there was the internet, there was social media. We talked to each other. And how we interpreted what we heard on the radio and then what we watched on television, what we read in the news, amongst each other, had, no one actually knows, but let's just say, as much impact as the mainstream media that reached us in the first place. And not everyone had equal influence, you know, in that Sunday afternoon conversation over the barbecue. Not everything got discussed equally and with equal objectivity, right? So there was filtering and there was amplification in social media pre-internet. What we're seeing playing out on Twitter, on Facebook, on various platforms, is exactly that human dynamic, but enabled on a digital platform that has scale and speed, which of course is superhuman, right? It takes on a different scale. So in that sense, it's always been a media story, but qualitatively, I think we're seeing a shift now. And I think that the big difference now is, independent of actually not just the mainstream media, but also independent of the candidates, so many people do now have a voice. And you know, the idea that every voice can be heard, I think we're seeing that play out. But our ability to tune in with incredible specificity and granularity to just the voices maybe we want to hear, or perhaps depending on the platform, some kind of algorithmic determinations of what we hear, all of that leads to, you know, in terms of the media dynamic, an ecosystem which, frankly, I think we're all still trying to map out. And it's even if you are one of the platforms hosting all those voices, it doesn't mean anyone fully understands
the dynamics
and the new structure that's emerging. But I go back to, you know, what did it look like before the internet? Because people haven't fundamentally changed. But when you change the channels, you change the medium, you can actually take those same human instincts and human dynamics and take us into a new place, which is, I think, where we are.
There is a public good and there is public service. But to echo what you said, I'm not sure there's a public anymore in a media sense.
I was going to ask about that. I mean, that we've heard for a long time about fracturing, and I'm not sure now if it isn't kind of fully complete, that the ability to really fully encircle yourself in a Facebook feed, in a Twitter feed, that tells you what you believe, to maybe even completely, you know, you can watch the debate streaming live on Twitter, so you don't even have to, you know, NBC, ABC, CBS, they don't have to be gatekeepers anymore. I'm not sure. I mean, you may have some sense of how complete the circle is and whether we're all living in these parallel circles.
Well, I mean, I do think that, you know, if you were running for president in 1980, you had three TV stations, maybe four. They had a half hour of news each night. And then you had the newspapers. And that was kind of it. And today, it's just such an altered media landscape as to be rendered unrecognizable. And you have Donald Trump, who has really only appeared on Fox News for the last 60 days plus, and for the most part, only on Hannity's show, right? And you're able to build these kind of discrete publics of sorts and back them up with some confirmation bias across social media. And that's, you know, that's a challenge. I will say, I don't think that's entirely a new challenge. In some ways, the objective, neutral press in the United States had a, like, 75-year run, roughly. But you know, I'm fond of saying the election of 1800, which was John Adams versus Thomas Jefferson, had two candidates who all of the newspapers at the time were partisan. They were either completely for one candidate or the other. You had newspapers printing stories about how Thomas Jefferson was a coward who fled the British and kept a harem in his Monticello, and how John Adams was scheming to marry his eldest daughter off to the King of England so as to build a royal dynasty in the United States. And I was going back and reading some of these accounts, and I was like, boy, this doesn't sound that different in some ways from partisan media today, right? And so I don't think it's an entirely new arrangement, but it is a different one, one that's certainly new in, like, the last few decades of American public life.
You've said that you think in some ways people will look back at the 2016 election and say that the media failed. Is it a failure, or are we just rounding the corner back into, you know, partisan media? Is this the 1820s? Or, you know?
I am beginning to think we are rounding a bit of a corner back to partisan media in some substantial way. You know, the role of the media in this cycle is, I think, unusual from a number of dimensions. And, you know, at the Shorenstein Center, we have some research looking at mainstream media outlets. Newspapers, TV stations, and their digital equivalents, and are looking at the volume of coverage, at the tone of coverage, positive, negative, neutral, at the types of coverage, and then trying to compare it to 2012, right? And one notable thing is that the sheer volume of coverage Trump gets is almost 3-1 more than his closest competitor, whoever his closest competitor is at the time, whether it's Ted Cruz or Hillary Clinton. And so just in the sheer volume of coverage, he's being treated really differently in many ways. And moreover, in articles about Hillary Clinton or in articles about Ted Cruz, in other words, in articles about Trump's opponents, the number one quoted source is Donald Trump. And in articles about Donald Trump, the number one quoted source is Donald Trump. And so that's a failure of sorts, I think.
Do you think that's a failure? Look, I mean, the media has, you know, they've got paychecks to write at the end of the month, and they're going for the most entertaining person.
That's right. I mean, look, I'm sure many people in this room know the feeling, like, you can't not look away when the next you know, thing has happened with Trump. You just have to. So there is this entertainment and gossip kind of dimension to this. Going back to your question around, you know, is this a media story? And we did a analysis. This is at our lab at MIT, where we went back to, I think it was 2009, the last season of the Celebrity Apprentice, and took all the people who were actively tweeting about the TV show, and then fast forward to 2016. And one of the things we are tracking at MIT is all of the people who are what we call exclusive followers of each candidate. So if you follow Donald Trump and only Donald Trump, but not any of the other candidates from either party, you know, from the primaries or now in the generals, or if you only follow Clinton, for example, that would be exclusive Trump followers, exclusive Clinton. So that's, you know, we're talking about millions of people across those two groups. And it turns out that roughly 10% of the people in 2009 who were tweeting about the Celebrity Apprentice TV show are now exclusive Trump followers, which is far higher than get from any kind of statistical. So it's not just, hey, there's a general brand or sort of mental model that was established from the entertainment Trump that now is playing out. It's literally the same people that we can track that are playing certain roles and, you know, active. I just want to point out, in terms of a very important positive role that the social media platforms are playing and where one could, let's say failure, it might be a strong word, but just say, and with Brexit in the rearview mirror where the media in Europe were caught flat-footed, it was a complete surprise. Many pollsters were surprised. The vote in Colombia was a surprise. So there seems to be a pattern emerging of surprise and empathy gap of even trying to understand where the issues are. One of the things we do is at our lab is systematically analyze top 30 news sources in America and find every story that is about the US elections and just code what topics, we see in the data exactly what you're reporting that, you know, Trump dominates. Also on Twitter, it's kind of a social mirror. Roughly 60% of the US election conversation is about Trump specifically, and all candidates and other issues are sort of in the other 40%. So he dominates the conversation. But when you look at, we'll take every day there's hundreds of thousands of tweets in English coming from the US about the elections. And when we analyze what fraction of those are about, we have sort of, we call it three Ps. Are people tweeting about the candidate's personality? Are they tweeting about the political process, kind of the horse race of who's winning, who's losing, campaign shifts, et cetera? Are they tweeting about policy issues, immigration, terrorism, gun control, et cetera? Roughly 20% are policy. So it would be nice maybe for some of us if it was 50%, but at least it's 20%. We're seeing over the calendar year a gradual increase in the conversation being about personality. It's obviously a huge factor, and we're seeing certainly over the last 2 months it's on par with all the chatter about the process. So if you do a deeper dive into policy and say, what do people care about within the policy bucket? And we have 25 issues that we've determined are sort of the issues of this election. Number one, it's not the economy, stupid. It's foreign policy. And that has been consistent, number one.
Foreign policy, like, so, don't have a war in Syria, don't put American boots
in Syria and Russia and China. Mm-hmm. And separate from that, we've broken out immigration as
okay,
a separate topic, which is a strong number two. And then race and racial issues is a very strong number three. And those three are really dominating overall the conversation on Twitter. If you then look at news coverage and you code, you know, what amounts to now sometimes a couple of thousand, if not many hundreds of stories a day, and this is across the spectrum from Breitbart to Washington Post and beyond. Racial issues, for example, are systematically underrepresented in terms of the kind of collective mainstream media attention. Campaign finance is overrepresented compared to conversation on Twitter. So those differences, and when I say underrepresented or over, I don't mean, oh, it's 17% here and only 14% there. So a kind of a dramatic example is in the 2 weeks leading up to the vice presidential nomination, we looked at how many news stories that were about the US elections were about the VP pick? And it was roughly a third. And this is across all the outlets, across, again, thousands of stories. So it was a 2 week window. In that same 2 week window, we took millions of tweets that are about the US elections and said, how many of the tweets were about the VP nominee? And the number was about 3%. So order of magnitude more interest amongst the media in this topic than, and actually, Trump said, people don't care about the VP pick. And you know, he's got a focus group of 12 million plus followers, so he can kind of query in real time and see what actually matters. by what resonates.
I'm interested from both of you. You talked about the empathy gap. Like, why was the British press not more on top of it with Brexit? You know, why haven't we been? Why was the, you know, were pundits not able to see that Trump was going to get the Republican nomination? Why did that happen? And I wonder if what it feels like to me is there's also a kind of elitism gap. So if you look at the elites, almost no matter what party they identified with 2 years ago, they're pretty much behind Hillary Clinton. I mean, George H.W. Bush, you know, I mean, the Bushes have completely disavowed Trump. I think you could argue that a lot of the foreign policy elite and the academic elite, you know, I mean, even if those people would say, I'm telling you, I voted Republican, you know, since I was able to vote, mm-hmm. not this year. But clearly, they are not representative of the whole country. So is there some kind of elitism gap that social media is able to pick up on, but the mainstream media in some ways hasn't?
Well, in 2004, one in every eight journalists was employed in New York, D.C., or in L.A. And 10 years later, it's one out of three. And so the collapse of journalism jobs in the United States happened everywhere except New York, D.C., and L.A. And that dramatically impacts local communities and municipalities. There's 21 U.S. states that have where the news outlets in those states send no one to cover Congress. That means that 21 states, their congressional delegations, their senators and their members of Congress never meet a journalist in D.C. who from their home who asks them what they're doing. And so I think, like journalism has become very elite and almost an elite product even. I mean, clearly the New York Times digital subscription model is an elite model of sorts.
Yeah, and I think even if you send a journalist, just the, you know, the view from the community versus going and spending time in the community. We were just talking before we came on stage about J.D. Vance and his book Hillbilly Elegy, and this view from the, you know, the kind of Appalachian view of what is happening in this case in small town Ohio, and kind of post steel mill. Just what life looks like, not just for the kind of base of the pyramid of that town, but the pretty much the entire pyramid that's left. The top of the pyramid's been able to move on, relocate, but there is. So I think when you say elite, I think that's a reasonable way to put it. I was just thinking, elite makes me think, you know, a very thin layer. But when I look at the total support, not only of Trump, but also Sanders, and I think it's a lot of similar, you know, you look at the, again, just look at the data, look at the conversations and sort of the themes that are driving support in both cases.
It's and Sanders or somebody else who didn't get, I don't think he had a lot of, you know, the foreign policy establishment. I don't think a lot of official DC was behind Bernie Sanders either.
That's right. That's what I'm saying.
The socialists? Is that what you're saying?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, a paraphrase of elite, not that there's anything wrong, but I think it might be broader. It's elite plus, which is if you were to make a binary distinction of, let's just say there's a system, which is not just the system of the political system, but also the understanding of the role of mainstream media, professional media as part of that system, and the proper role of corporate America and corporate leadership, business leaders, et cetera. There's a system in place. And we're to ask the question, maybe if J.D. Vance was here, and that would be so illuminating, to say binary yes or no, you are a beneficiary of the system. And the way to think about the answer is, if you blew it up, would you be better or worse off when the peace is settled and you have no idea post blow up how they're going to settle? And if you, in that forced choice, said, okay, I'm for the system because I'd be worried if it blew up, things would be worse. That certainly would capture all of what you'd call the elite, but it might cover a broader group. That it's sort of like people who are for whom the system is working. So I, you know, my interpretation of a lot of this, which is just kind of having been looking at a lot of, you know, certainly the data and kind of voices on Twitter, but also just trying to piece together some of these gaps, is that there is a growing recognition where of the failings of the system, and that this is a kind of sort of anti-system voice that we're hearing, and where I personally have felt the empathy gap is trying to understand how could you possibly think that kind of hitting detonate could be a good thing. And it's forced me, this election cycle has forced me to go and tune into voices like J.D. Vance, who are very illuminating. I'm not saying he's got all the answers, that's kind of one view, but it's real. I mean, he lived it, and he gives a view where to say, oh, it's the people who are supporting this candidate are X, Y, and Z. Actually, there are some, you know, where X might be racist, and Y might be, you know, protectionist, and you might have all these. Actually, there's many, the Venn diagram is partially overlapping. And when you look at the composite of all of these different groups, it's not that everyone is anyone in any one camp. It's a complex set of issues, but if there is like an Uber issue, New York Times at some point called Donald Trump the America's first post-policy candidate. They were kind of looking for the policy and calling it post-policy. But if your policy is about the system itself, that sort of is analysis, then he's, well, that's a spider coming down on me. I think it's telling me to shut up. That was like a timer. It's like a Google. That was a robot spider.
They're very high tech.
I think I'll stop right there. Yeah.
Well, I would say that, you know, I'm about to say something, but before I say it, let me qualify. I think that Donald Trump is a racist, misogynist, who I don't endorse those views. But there are three issues that significantly motivate his base that actually have long precedent in American politics. I would look back. The research is clear on they're the same three issues that motivated Ross Perot voters, right? Ross Perot captured almost 19% of the popular vote in the United States around three issues: protectionism and free trade, and the economy not working for people, anti-NAFTA, anti-immigrant, and a kind of isolationist sentiment and worldview, and political corruption and political reform. Mm-hmm. And those were he ran on those three issues very clearly. He was articulate and smart and not racist and offensive in arguing for that point of view. And after dropping out twice in 6 months, still ended up with almost a fifth of the popular vote. And those three issues, to a large extent, animate Donald Trump's candidacy. And if he wasn't such an offensive person, I think he would be. I think those three issues are potentially strong enough to have a very strong showing in the presidential race.
I think that's really interesting because I have felt largely like this has been a campaign where issues don't get a lot of airing. I mean, I think about how many questions have you heard in presidential, vice presidential debates about education, right? I mean, you think, what could be more important than educating sort of the next generation? And I mean, you just hear very, very little about that and a lot about personality. Is somebody an honest person? Are they a racist person? Which is, I mean, it has bearing, but it doesn't feel like it's about issues. But it sounds like you feel like, no, there are some really core issues, and that's why, you know, speaking for Trump anyway, Trump has this really core, unbreakable.
Well, part of his appeal, certainly in the part of his appeal in the primary and in the general, is those three issues: protectionism, mm-hmm. isolationism/immigration, and political corruption, are three issues where the two major parties have been in sync. Right? Like the two parties for the last 20 years plus have really had the same point of view on free trade, on immigration, and on political corruption, political reform. and articulating an alternative is a very powerful message.
In a couple minutes, I want to go to your questions. So if you have questions, there's a microphone here and there's a microphone here. Just stand up behind the microphone if you have a question, and we'll...
I also want to say one other thing about the issues. I think that it's actually really dangerous for the country not to have a political campaign about issues. There are structural reasons why we don't have a campaign on the issues, I believe, and part of it is it's a two-year freaking process, and people have to have something to talk about every day. And the reality is that Hillary Clinton's education policy not going to change much over 2 years. And so it's not something to talk about every day for 2 years. But the problem of having an issue-free presidential campaign is that when there is a central issue or two or three in a presidential campaign and someone wins, then they can legitimately say to the other party, I have a mandate to pursue this issue. We put this to a vote and the people are with me. And so come on, Congress and the opposing party, let's make a deal. And there will be no such mandate for Hillary Clinton in this election.
I was just going to say that I definitely agree with the importance of these issues. I guess I would just prioritize one over the other two of your three, which is the corruption of the system. And when I mentioned the kind of putting support for Sanders and Trump into the same category, it's primarily because of that issue. And some of the things that I actually blissfully still in Canada during as a Canadian and during Perot, so I don't know the details, but I suspect some of the raising some of the issues around voter fraud and this election, you know, the potential of election being stolen from Trump and so forth. These are all part of a multifaceted attack of the system itself. So the idea of where do we stand on different issues, but one of the issues when you make it the system, that's kind of the container for the issues. And that's what I meant by that kind of thought experiment of this binary forced choice. Another book, just J.D. Vance, I've just found to be really an interesting perspective. Another one, which is over half a century old, Eric Hoffer, True Believers, mm-hmm. Just a very interesting book about the kind of ideal conditions under which revolutions have happened in the past, whether it's a political or religious revolution. Part of it is the characteristics of the leader of a revolution, and part of it is the kind of ideal conditions. Amongst the population. Hoffer talks about the recently poor. So this is a concept that he finds that appears over and over across different revolutions historically, where recent means within living memory. So if your grandparents' generation remembers, things were different. But there's been enough time that's passed and enough different people in control that you start to get the sense that things will not get better, but you still remember, as opposed to, you know, if it's been bad for generations, you're kind of, you'll accept it. And so his thesis was to look at when those conditions hold, and then you have a certain kind of leader that's critical to catalyze, you can actually have big shifts. I'm not saying we're going to have a Hoffer-style revolution in America, but again, just as to get some insight into kind of what has led shape my thinking as I've tried to interpret what is a chaotic number of signals. And one frame is to look at it in terms of issues, but to what degree does that framing accept some elements of there being a system that is not questioned? And when those are questioned and you have people, we had, our lab is one of the official partners to the Commission for Presidential Debates. And so we have prepared an analytics brief for the moderator for each of the debates, and we will for this, the final debate that they take as an input to prepare for the, and so as part of that, they've invited us, although we're not journalists, we're a lab full of mainly technologists, we do have some journalists on our team. We were accredited as an official journalist for the debates, which means we had a seat in the media center. And it just turned out our team was there for the most recent debate, And to their surprise, when they happened to be getting food, so they were in the food center. There's a lot of people who worked at the university who are, serving in that room. And at that very moment, Trump delivered his line that, you know, if I was making the laws, you'd be in jail. And the room erupted in applause. I mean, it was just like, and they were just caught off guard. But just so, which is kind of, you know, again, I interpret as that's not an issue. And that's not even a person. That's kind of like, if you really think the system is broken, you'll
jail them. I'm going to push a little. I mean, I generally agree the system, by the way, is broken. It's especially broken for people born after 1980, right? That kind of statistically speaking, if you're born after 1980, you're just going to be worse off than your parents in almost every measurable way. But I also think that less than 5% of the eligible voting population made Donald Trump the nominee. And same for Hillary. Less than 5% of the voting population voted for her in the primaries. And so there's a pretty small number of people choosing to participate and to offer that indictment of the system.
But more people than that will choose to participate on November 8th. I mean, Donald Trump was able to expand out, and so was Hillary.
And there was a recent poll, I forget who, was it Wall Street Journal, asked members of the Republican Party, should Trump be removed? And two-thirds said no. He should remain, which is a pretty high number.
I just think that if people really wanted to burn the system down, mm-hmm. and I'm saying there are good reasons they should want to, I would expect a much higher turnout in the primaries for a candidate who is pledging to do that. Mm-hmm. I mean, primary participation this time was actually the lowest. There was much higher primary participation in 08 when Obama ran.
I know you've got great questions, so don't be shy and line up, because we're ready to take them whenever you've got them. Deb, I want to ask you something about, you know, obviously MIT is really, I mean, your lab particularly is really looking at all this input from social media, but not everybody is on social media. Twitter's like 20-30% of the country. Facebook, more like 70%, is that right? So tell me, like, what some of the device, and just because you're on Twitter or on Facebook doesn't mean you do anything with that. I mean, you could have just have an account and logged in once. There's obviously heavy, heavy Twitter users, heavy, you know, people who check Facebook and post things every day. So is there a divide emerging from between the people who let their voice be heard and the people who don't, who either aren't on it or sit in the background and maybe think something else, but nobody, besides maybe Election Day, nobody hears from those people. I don't know who those people are. Is it a racial divide? Is it a gender divide? Is it an age divide? I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I think the answer is absolutely yes. Not everyone is on any of these platforms. Clearly not everyone is speaking out equally. And going back to the original kind of first question you asked, just about is this a media story and what's happening? Is there a new media ecosystem really emerging? I think the answer is yes. And what new roles are being played? On Twitter, there is a certain kind of user who's really a power user and has huge influence, who he or she themselves says almost nothing. Because, the traditional media, kind of if you're a newspaper, you had content creation and content distribution, sort of two major functions. And so it was news gathering and analysis and synthesis, and then the whole distribution chain. Well, those two have come completely apart. And you can see it clearly on a platform like Twitter, where certain people, the role they're playing is through retweeting. And basically, they're a redistributor. So they're a broadcast node, but not creating content themselves, but of course being selective of what content they're pushing out. And they've built enormous followerships. So there's different roles. But again, most people are not playing that role. So I think, like, if there's if there's one law of media, it's the power law. It's that there is a very high head to the... So if you look at book sales, music sales, any kind of media consumption statistics, and say, what's the difference between the number one and the number two rank So the number one top-selling book in the last week versus number two versus number three, and you plot, what you'll get is a curve that looks like this. It's a very steep fall off. So number one, you know, just crushes number two, which crushes number three, and very quickly it falls off, and there's a long tail. And I think that is just, we could ask why that is, why it's a kind of a universal, it seems. Maybe the highest quality content finds the biggest audience. Maybe everyone wants to have some shared common ground, so we try to tune into where others are tuning in. So I think there are a new broadcaster class emergent in social media. And the funny thing is, there's more of them. There isn't the same capital costs, right? You don't need a broadcasting, you don't need a printing press, you don't need a studio, et cetera. But you do need to build an audience, and the audience is finite. So that head of the distribution applies also. There are many people who are silent or on the long tail. Mm-hmm. And so I think it would be a mistake to just say, oh, this is what people are tweeting about. This is what, you know, people are showing up to a focus group and talking about.
Right.
All
therefore,
of these.
That's where America
that's
is.
Where America is.
One might argue Donald Trump has that problem of misinterpreting his Twitter followers as a focus group for where the country is.
It could. On the other hand, one could say it's the one of the ultimate real-time focus groups to tune your message before you rebroadcast on other media, and that you can test it for resonance.
Well, he's doing that. He's just doing it with a pretty narrow slice of the population.
Yeah, that's right. Using various other media channels to amplify.
Yeah. Question over here.
Hi, good evening. I'd like to hear your thoughts on the use, on the ethics of PR campaigns, highly effective, highly paid, in the media that used to disseminate, to manipulate public opinion or disseminate propaganda. You can use it in the context of presidential elections, the ethics of PR campaigns.
Are you talking like about a politician hiring a PR firm to sort of
like
get their message
trolling,
out there?
The dissemination of opinion.
It's interesting because Deb got a little bit to a piece of this, which is not a paid PR thing, but Clay Shirky has talked about Obama Girl. Raise your hand if you remember Obama Girl. A few people. Okay, well, Obama Girl, go home and check it out. She made these like music videos, right?
Sure.
She like really loved Obama. She was kind of like young, and there were these kind of these sexy videos, and I have a crush on Obama. She was not employed by Obama. She was not employed. You know, she wasn't part of the media. And he was saying it was like the first time he realized that there could be like a third actor in there, people who just created their own thing and was like, I'm for Trump or I'm against Trump and I'm going to start putting things out there. But whether it's that or paid PR.
Seriously, we haven't seen as much of that this cycle. I mean, I think that.
Oh, Breitbart. I mean, isn't that kind of a synergy?
It's more institutional. I would say like. If you look at the 2004 election, the 2008 election, the 2012 election, each of those elections, there were what I would call grassroots or netroots operators who dreamed up something that got to scale very quickly from completely from outside campaign or even professional political infrastructure. And there's been almost none of that this cycle that I've seen.
Well, I think about
although I guess the most tweeted tweet from the debate Sunday night, right? I'm a Muslim. I'm calling to report a man harassing a woman, attacking a woman on stage.
Was a professor, right?
Yeah.
I
mean,
so
not from the traditional
period. So I guess I would, to your question about manipulation, this is a concern. You're on social media, so you think this is just a person voicing their actual opinion, but it's actually a paid opinion. And there's a virtual arms race of this happening, not just around the elections, but in general. There are countries where the internet is not censored, but there's actually active forces that are paid to create sort of counter messaging. One of the interesting things is if you just think about your own experience, if you use any social media platform, is you know the source. There are people you know, and they know you, so there's kind of known relations on platforms. And the same message from someone you know, from a source you know and trust, versus, let's say, someone who's paid, We have a pretty good sense of those we know, sources that are well established, and new voices. So I'm not saying there's a perfect solution, but just the way each of us individually processes a message, we take into account where it came from. So I think there's some filtering that is done by people for themselves. In fact, that can lead to the, you know, we're talking before about this kind of fragmentation, where you might end up creating a network that actually doesn't allow those voices in. But I guess I don't have anything new to say about manipulation. I mean, it's an old topic. There's new tools, new weapons to take it to another level.
I do think in terms of the ethics of it, there's a bit of a fine line between advocating for an issue that you want to shape public opinion around because you believe it, and paying actors to manipulate their point of view.
I think this idea that Breitbart is an institution, I agree. It's clearly now a de facto institution, but it's interesting to see its unusual origins. And I was going to say, just imagine there is a set of very interesting algorithms. Actually, Google was built on, you know, PageRank, that Larry Page invented, which is one of the standard algorithms now. Given a network, if you want to know which nodes, if this is a human network, who is most influential in a network, one way to answer that, there's many ways to answer that question. One is look at how many people link to you, and the more people link to you, the more influential you are, especially if each of the people linked to you also have more people linking to them. And dot dot dot. So you have this idea of influence. It doesn't. If you have a small number of followers, but they have many followers themselves, that can actually make you quite influential. So it's not just about how many people you're connected to, but how influential they are. And so there's this notion. By that analysis, when we look at all the people tweeting about immigration in the context of U.S. Immigration, U.S. Election, we will find a lot of the institutional, you know, the Breitbarts and CNNs, kind of the mix of left and right, as being highly influential. When we then say, well, if you know Twitter, the way it works is you can have what's called asymmetric follow. So I can follow you because I'm interested in what you have to say, but you don't have to follow me back. But if you choose to follow me back, that tends to be a different kind of relationship. So you're more likely that we know each other. There's various properties when there's a mutual follow. If you look at the network of mutual follows of people who follow each other and are talking about immigration or talking about guns, and then you compute PageRank, you find the most influential people, it's a completely different set of actors. The mainstream sources disappear from the analysis. Mm-hmm. And there's this different category of people who have often tens of thousands, often hundreds of thousands of followers. And I bet you many of the top 100 for any issue, no one in this room's ever heard of. And so I think there is actually a vibrant new ecosystem with and some of these nodes are not saying anything new. They're just selectively, taking things from Breitbart or CNN or New York Times and rebroadcasting. Often they're adding commentary on top, but they're playing this role, which this is a new role. I don't know where that existed before. So I think there's actually a big emergent class of kind of new media actors.
Let me grab this question here.
Going to ask a similar question, so I'll ask a harder one. If we are worried that we're turning a corner into more media isolation and bias in different social communities, but at the same time encourage that these old walls are coming down and we're all freer and more interesting, what can be done to make the new world of media and social media more effective and truthful? If you could make some small change to the structure of how these social networks work, what would it be?
And I'll just piggyback onto that, which is that the 20-somethings I work with don't watch television. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's widespread. I have not done a scientific study of this, but like I would say I grew up, like when I watched my grandparents, my parents, they watched television. Is that being written out of the equation? I mean,
did they watch the Saturday Night Live 10-minute clip? that was originally on television, but then went everywhere. So when you so they don't watch
Nobody
television.
Nobody watched Saturday Night Live. I watch Saturday Night Live. I mean, I don't.
So like I was referring to there was I don't know if anyone here is, I'm sure some of you have seen the SNL take Alec Baldwin playing Trump.
Oh yeah yeah yeah.
So
yeah.
I bet you many of those 20 somethings have seen that clip. I'm just pointing out that television
yes.
content's reaching them, but again, the distribution channel
TV's
is.
TV's a poor word.
TV's a bad word, yeah.
But that's so different. You know, a 4-minute clip is so different from, like,
yes.
I remember my grandfather watching, like, McNeil and Aaron Hughes Hour. Like, that's a very different
deal.
But, sorry, we shouldn't lose the question if you about what do we do.
You answered that one. That one's hard.
Yeah, I was going to say, yeah, that's what I was saying. Please. No, look, I think this notion of a cocoon or a filter bubble or, you know, people use phrases like cyber balkanization, there's some kind of sense that there is this decoupling. First of all, get a map of to what degree is that happening. I think everyone gets a sense it is happening. How much of that is being driven by certain platforms and design of platforms versus just, you know, the technology platforms giving the people what they want, which is actually to self-select and create these. But we've never had the ability to have what we want so extreme. And so it's created this, this separation. If we think cocoons equal some kind of fragmentation and sort of to the detriment of the whole, then it makes sense to think about strategies to not to. I think trying to bust cocoons is hopeless. It reflects something that we're instinctually trying to do. So you know, the kind of tribal and just sort of comfort of being amongst those who have shared values and shared interests. But thinking about what are kinds of interactions that would be good to have if there were cocoons, bridges, empathy. You know, I think one of the things is it's not just about truth and having a shared set of facts. When I think about topics like religion and faith, it's actually not about truth. So sometimes we do a lot of work in data journalism and thinking about data-grounded objectivity of reporting and so forth. But there's realms of life where I think something more like empathy, which is having an understanding of a different viewpoint, which is not grounded in some objective set of facts, is equally important. I think they're both important. So how do you build bridges between cocoons? If you do this kind of network analysis and you find polarization, which we see in spades, it's interesting to find some of those nodes that are actually have somehow built an audience or connectivity across the divide. Who are they? I don't know, but who are they? What if you were to find ways to engage them? Because somehow they've created a role or a position in the network where they are actually embedded in, you know, across. They may be the minority, but are there ways to not only identify but engage and strengthen the role? Some people will say, you know, it's not clear that building bridges is necessarily a good thing. Maybe one cocoon should just win. So there's also kind of culture dependencies and how we even think about what.
So
what's the improvement?
I guess my point of view is that this really depends on the answer to your question. What features should be built into technology platforms to improve the state of public life, and the public good? This really depends on what kind of world do we want to live in and what constitutes the public good. And if I look to newspapers and the history of newspapers as an analogy, at the turn of the century, yellow journalism was rampant. Newspapers had near monopolies on shared public experience, and they abused those. They lied. They said things that weren't true. They tried to start wars, and through kind of a variety of discussions and conversations and some carrot, some stick, and some regulation, and some like the Pulitzer Prizes exist to, they came into being to try and encourage newspapers to be more civic minded and more public, more interested in the public good. News came over approximately 50 years to develop a set of values that said, there are things that are important to the public good, and we have a responsibility to the public to promote and encourage those things, to hold power accountable, to tell the truth, to make sure that things are sourced with more than one source. And I think that technology platform companies, for all of their exclamations that they are purely technology products, the big ones have actually a kind of monopoly on public attention. And they have to make value decisions about what might be good for the public. And just like I don't think it was healthy for newspapers to have that conversation in private, that was like a broader conversation that had to happen in the country, I think that's true of the tech industry. That before we can get to specific features, we need some consensus that companies like Google, Facebook, and Twitter have a disproportionate impact on what constitutes public opinion and what the public is. And we have to make a decision that we want fewer silos and more shared experience, even if that's not what consumers want. And then we can talk about what constitutes the public good and what are the core values that need to be encouraged there. And I think that part of the discussion right now about bullying and hate speech on Twitter is the beginning of that. I think Google has gone through this in terms of whether it should include anti-vaccine, demonstrably proven false anti-vaccine messages in Google search results when it might actually endanger my children. Those are important and legitimate questions to ask. But we're not having any of those conversations in any meaningful way.
We are up against the clock, so I'm going to take both of these questions together. If you can just ask one and then ask the next, and then you can sort of pick and choose, answer them together or whatever.
So one of the types of content that seems to disseminate very rapidly through social media now is these comic memes. So you've got Hillary Clinton on her cell phone, and then people will caption it, or Bernie Sanders' head on top of a bodybuilder. And there's even been mainstream media pickup on this. Bernie Sanders' dank meme stash was a page on Facebook. And so my question to you is this just a new form of comedy? Or does this political humor have some new special role that has only emerged through things like Twitter and Instagram and Facebook?
Okay, new political humor. Let's hear the next one.
And thank you for having this talk. This is pretty awesome. But I personally believe that we're a high-tech society running on outdated infrastructure. And so my question is, if you look at American Idol, you can quickly get an opinion on something very fast. Do we need more technology integrated into our government systems to create a more collaborative country to satisfy the goals that we need to address?
So you've got kind of humor in technology and more tech in politics. Either of those, both of those, want to?
Well, I think maybe just to comment briefly on the second question. The first, I guess, my answer is I don't know if anything has significantly changed. It feels like there's, I don't know. It's probably where I'll leave it. And briefly on the second, we've had a lot of discussion just amongst my colleagues and I around the need for potentially not just thinking about new technology to reinforce and make the existing system more efficient, but thinking about, you know, the internet invites thinking about decentralized distributed governance and just very different models of how decisions are made. Because when you have that kind of real-time read on what people want for one given topic, how does that bump into all the other kind of instant reads you could get on different aspects, which will, of course, conflict? And so it leads to, all of the fundamental challenges of governance. But top-down hierarchies seem to be outmoded. And we the people are networked and have become more complex than ever to govern. And so thinking about what lies beyond hierarchical models, where technology may actually be a sort of enabler for completely different modes. I think it's a fascinating question. How to do experiments, how to do pilots, embedded within the system we've got, I think is a, to kind of bring that into practical sphere is an important question.
I'm decidedly more skeptical than Deb on this question. And I'll start by saying I started my life as a developer in an open source world. And so I come from a relatively technical background. And I, you may be familiar with Godwin's law. In any online discussion, given enough time, someone gets compared to Hitler. And I'm suspicious of technology's ability to provide exceptional discourse, because I don't know that we see that it's demonstrably any better. And in fact, on issues of justice, on issues of war and peace, I'm not sure it works as well. That said, I think that the infrastructure of our democracy dramatically needs an overhaul, that we vote on Tuesday because Sunday is church day and Monday is market day, and you ride your horse and buggy into town to vote on Tuesday. And we have 435 members of the House of Representatives, because basically in the 20s they decided that's how many seats comfortably fit in the room. And members of Congress aren't allowed to vote from their home districts. I mean, I think kind of across the board, there are some substantial things to be done. But I fundamentally believe in representative democracy as a well-established way of balancing, the majority and the minority and coming to different conclusions that respect justice and equality and the rule of law.
I'm going to give you both a last quick question. When you think about the 2020 election, and you think about the role the media is going to play, and I mean, we have talked for an hour about how, in some ways, amazing and different the 2016 election has been from maybe anything anybody's ever seen, and people say it all the time. What, I mean, if there's a trend, if we're living through something that somebody's going to look back someday and say, you can see it on the chart there. What is that? What's going on with the media, and where is it headed once this trend gets a little more mature?
I think that the parties are fragile and nearly bankrupt and provide no local infrastructure. The only thing the political parties provide is major donors. And that means that if you can self-fund a la Donald Trump, or you can raise money online from small dollar donors in any substantial way, like Barack Obama in 08 or Bernie Sanders in 2016, you can substantially disrupt you can end up a presidential candidate. You can end up a major nominee. You can have a decent shot at being president of the United States.
And as you pointed out before, Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders weren't even really 2 years ago in the parties that they
correct. They're not even part of them. Neither of them are actually from either of the parties. And then that's further complicated by the decline of the press as gatekeepers. And so the parties aren't gatekeepers anymore, and the press aren't gatekeepers. And so that means pretty much anybody with money, ambition, and an appetite for talent, for an appetite for intensity and polarization, has a decent shot at being at the White House. And that describes, I'd say, two-thirds of the white men I know. And so, I think when I look at 2020 and 2024, I see a lot of chaos as all of the traditional ways of vetting people to hold the most important position in, I'd argue, in the world, have collapsed or are so fragile that they're easily bypassed or dismissed. And that's very dangerous. Everybody should read Upton Sinclair, Can't Happen Here.
So 2020, white men and chaos.
I'm thinking Nicco for president, 2020.
Yeah, no.
Well, maybe.
I wasn't born in the United States.
Yeah. Here's and on a note of optimism, just a comment you made in passing about the introduction of the Pulitzer. I was just thinking about introduction of the equivalent for these new actors in the ecosystem. Because I actually think, just going back to the question of what can we do about it, I do think the technology platforms play a role. I think you have to look at the design of the platforms. There's fundamental differences in Twitter's kind of direct feed, whoever you subscribe to or you follow, all of those will enter in your feed. Whereas if you have a, we mentioned Google, so what search results come back? Well, you're not going to get all the results back. And even if you do, you're only going to look at the first page. And so there's, depending on the design of the actual product or service, the platforms can play and sort of how they tune their algorithms can have a huge role. But I think the other super important factor here, player here, are the people. And again, there are certain new actors. Mainstream media hasn't gone away. It's just other elements that are layering on top. You know, going to the kind of comedy, kind of the comic memes, a young woman who has a good taste, who has good taste in cat videos and how to put on lipstick, can gather a following of millions. That's the world we live in. And you know, with that audience and with that influence, perhaps comes some responsibility. And you know, how would you actually raise the bar and say, listen, you actually have this platform now, and congratulations, you've created this audience. Did you know you could actually, in various ways, play a civic role? Now, that's not a word that, you know, a 19-year-old with a following wants to hear. Civic makes you, you know. So what's the equivalent of the Pulitzer Prize that is the cat's meow, pardon the pun, for all those cat video makers, et cetera, to start leveraging these new nodes of influence in the system? Because I think the influence there is real. I don't know to what degree, you know, the kind of that collective realizes that they are a new kind of gatekeeper, new kind of, so it's not totally flat. There is structure there. The power law, the media law still exists, but like, what does the Pulitzer Prize mean to these people? Nothing. It seems like it's a, you know, in newspaper you have the comics packaged with the sports, packaged with, you know, Andrew Hayward, former president of CBS News, part of our lab, said the saying always in the newsroom at CBS was make the important news interesting and make the interesting news important, right? And it was kind of these two pieces together is how you made the news. If you have the ability to make important things interesting, are you even aware? Are you motivated? Is there some kind of a system? So I think there's a, can we create that system? So. Maybe by 2020.
Can you create that? That's your job.
Yeah. Well, thanks to a great audience and great questions. And Nicco, Mele, Deb Roy, thank you for a wonderful hour.
Thank you.
We'll have the next one at the end of November. See you then.